And welcome back. As always on The Breakfast, we have a little, you know, segment where we talk about things that happened every day in history. And today, we're looking back at 1903. One of the most popular names in Nigeria's history, Frederick Lugard, comes into play on this day. But I'm starting the story by talking about what happened in 1804. The Sokoto Caliphate, you know, a lot of people may not know much about it, but it at that time was a sovereign Sunni Muslim caliphate in West Africa that was founded during the jihad jihad of the Fulani War, basically, by Usman Danfodio. It was dissolved on this day when the British attacked the caliphate in 1903, and it was then annexed into the newly established Northern Nigeria Protectorate. In 1899, Lord Lugard had proclaimed a British protectorate over much of the Sokoto Caliphate. The challenge really that they had then was, you know, to defeat the Sokoto Caliphate and defeat the resistance that they had back then. And then in 1900, a military campaign was launched to subdue the Caliphate. The British pacification campaign, termed the Kano-Sokoto Expedition, set off in Zaria at the end of January 1903. It was on this day, you know, that it eventually fell. One of the reasons was because, of course, they had higher firepower. They back then in 1903 were supported by 75 millimeter mountain guns, and it, you know, when I read that, I was shocked, you know, that they had that level of type of ammunition back then. Of course, that they used to eventually win the war. After sporadic fighting outside the walls and the fourth of the Sokoto Caliphate, the British eventually managed to penetrate the defensive parameters of the capital. Kano was at that time left defenseless because the MI of Kano was out of town. It was somewhere in, I'm not sure, somewhere in Sokoto at the time that it happened. He was called the Madakin Kano. And okay, actually, someone called the Madakin Kano, a local noble, rallied, you know, all the soldiers and all the men in the caliphate at that time to try to defend, but it was unsuccessful. And then talking about Frederick Lugard now, who led this campaign, he was at that time the British colonial administrator of West Africa from 1895. He was one of the foremost practitioners of the colonial system of indirect rule. The British at that time also considered traditional rulers as subject to their laws. And every time that any traditional ruler, you know, was getting a little stubborn, he was removed. Still the same process that seems to be happening in our world today, not just with the British, but colonial masters from, you know, from Britain and from France also in certain African countries, if you pay close attention. By the time Lord Lugard resigned as commissioner in 1906, the entire region of what would be eventually transformed into modern-day Nigeria, as we know it today, was being peacefully administered under supervision of British residents. He was knighted in 1901 for his victory in Nigeria and for defeating the Sokoto Caliphate, and returned in 1912 to eventually merge both the northern and southern protectorates back then. And that's what we eventually have as Nigeria today. And that's really where a lot of people would be, you know, have, you know, claimed to be upset, you know, with Lugard about. You know, what was the need for merging? What was the need for bringing these two very, you know, seemingly separate people together as one nation?
Well, the questions, the answer is quite evident throughout history. The British were imperialists, right? And they basically wanted to seek out other countries where they could easily access raw materials and, of course, cheap labor because it was a height of the slave trade. So basically, integrating, so to speak, the North and the South, you know, into one, the Northern and the Southern Protectorate, is basically for ease of indirect rule, ease of rule, and, of course, for ease of trade and the market. So anyway.
You know, there's, you know, the part where they also needed some level of control. There's a part where they were able to decide, you know, if you go a little further, they were able to decide who, you know, they thought or what part of the, you know, two protectorates, the people that they felt would be easier to manipulate, that they felt would be easier to leave in charge of the protectorates. And so further, you know, down in the story, you can see how they played it out. You know, but what I'm really concerned about, or one part I'm really concerned about, is how between 1903 and 1904, actually 1804, when the Sokoto Caliphate was really, really big, till date, after it fell, you can still see that method of operation, you know, by the British and by France and other countries that, and Russia even, that have continued to exert the same, you know, operating procedures in African countries. People claim, or well, if you read clearly, you would see that France still has a lot of influence in certain countries that they colonize here
well,
in Africa.
These questions are embedded in history, basically. The difference between the British colonial system and that of the French and the Portuguese were quite evident. Mm. I mean, when you talked about countries like French, they practiced the system of what they call assimilation. They basically wanted to make Frenchmen out of someone in Côte d'Ivoire. They wanted to make French people out of someone in Senegal. So their aim, their thought process was basically to make you into them. They thought you in their language. You attended their schools such that you can go to their country at the end of the day and thrive. You can find right now that if you check players, you know, in France, they have roots basically in these African countries because that was the system. That was a system of colonialism, so to speak, the assimilation that was practiced by the French and others. It's totally different and separate from the British colonial system.
Absolutely. But, the parts that are still very similar, the fact that they still have some level of influence in directing the growth parts of those countries.
Well, that's the neo-colonialist, influence, really. And it's up to African leaders to break away from that. But you find out that it's the leaders who actually vacate their 300 days out of 365. Oof. So next up today in history, it's the day the music died, February 3rd, 1959. And what happened today was that three rock and roll musicians, Buddy Holly, Ritchie Valens, and J.P. Richardson, also known as the Big Bopper, they died in a plane crash near Clear Lake in Iowa. So I mentioned earlier at the beginning of the, you know, the breakfast, and I sang the song, la 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 bam bam, don't mind my director, he's not letting me shine, you know, letting you see my dance moves. But that song was sang by Ritchie Valens. He was just 17 years old at the time. He sang that song. He was in the band, you know, with Holly, the Big Bopper, and the rest of them. They had done some remarkable work in history, you know, changing the face of rock and roll music. They were very popular. Ritchie Valens, in particular, was called the California Kid. And they had a music tour. They were traveling to different states. So what happened was their bus was giving them issues. You know, it was snowing. And the bus was breaking down. It was a school bus that, even the school had abandoned. And they were using that for their tour. But the bus continually broke down. And they said, you know what, instead of for us to keep having this issue with our bus, let's charter a plane. So they chartered a small plane and they flew so they could have some time. I remember that one of the musicians said he wanted to use a plane so that he could arrive, you know, for his tour a day early so he could do some laundry and rest. And they chartered the plane. They were on the flight just a few minutes after takeoff. They crashed. The issue with this, you know, reminds me of Kobe Bryant's death and how it was a very small plane, how, you know, weather conditions for flying was not very good and how the pilots flying it didn't have the requisite skills to fly that kind of a plane at the time he did. And the plane crashed and it was just so sad because, you know, for Ritchie Valens in particular, he always had a fear of planes. He always thought he was going to die in a plane crash. He eventually did. One of the other musicians, Buddy, his wife Maria, had a dream the night before that he was falling from the sky, told him not to fly, but he eventually flew. And one of the other musicians on their tour, this is going to sound very weird, but it happened, right? He was supposed to come with them on the plane, but he insisted he was going to continue with the bus. And one of the guys who died said, I hope your bus freezes because it was snowing. And he said, I hope your plane crashes. And eventually the plane crashed. And he said for many years, he said, let me read what he said, and I quote. He said, God Almighty, for many years, I thought I was responsible for the crash. And he basically didn't have rest for so many years. You know, during interviews, he talked about how he said, I hope your plane crashes. And the plane crashed and killed all four of them.
That is wild. So two things from this thing, these are pretty obvious. First one would be being very careful with what you say.
What you say,
and,
yes.
And the words that you speak. A lot of times we say things and then immediately in our hearts say, God forbid. But it doesn't take away the thing that you've said. So
and
that's the first one.
And the fact that you didn't even say it out, exactly. You didn't vocalize your...
even
your,
if you say it out, you know,
your
but
vocation.
The fact that you've already, you know, made certain proclamations or...
You sent it out into
words,
the universe.
You know, people need to take those things, you know, more seriously. The second one is, this is why when your mother calls you and says...
Or your wife.
I had a dream.
You take her seriously.
You should take it seriously. You should take it seriously.
Oh,
sometimes
God.
They're not just trying to be killjoys. They actually did have a dream, and you should take it seriously.
Yeah, so pay some tribute to these guys. Check out La Bam Bam on YouTube. Check out the music. They did do some great work back in their day, and I pray that their soul, you know, rest in peace.
Absolutely. That's all we have for you today in history, 1904. And what year was that?
And 1959. The day music died.
We're going straight into our first major conversation this morning. NINs have been, of course, given another 8 weeks. We'll talk a little bit about that this morning. And much later, Oju Zokalu is saying that he doesn't want to be retried. And it's a huge mistake if that happens. Stick around.